The first thing that we do when we come into this life is to inhale. And the last thing that we will do before leaving this life is to exhale. In between that first inhale and the last exhale is our life.
Initially, I came to a yoga practice because I was looking for some sort of physical discipline. But now I recognize it as a path to realize myself.
The way is finding originally who we are, to be sincerely you.
Yoga is not something that you can do. Yoga is who you are. Yoga is the natural state.
A yogi is not normal. No, a yogi wants liberation.
We create the capacity inside of our bodies to cause the state of yoga.
Yogaschitta vritti nirodha.
The last thing people think you're addressing is your mind.
Yoga practice is a way to strip away confusion.
It's grace. It's a pure gift.
You come to a place of peace and centeredness.
You can't go and get it because it's right here. It's in the present moment.
You are yoga, but you forgot.
You have to shut up and listen.
It reminds you where to return to all the time, and where you live and who you are.
To see ourselves in others is what it's all about.
It feels like what I'm made for.
Yoga is a union with God in us. God, us. God in us. This is yoga.
We are all this. Together, we are all this.
Head yoga. He can make yoga.
Can you make yoga?
Yeah, I make.
Yeah.
No, only man. Man people is making yoga.
Yoga.
You know, and many festival time, and many holy man coming ghat, and he make yoga.
In moments, the best response to what is yoga is silence.
The yoga tradition has been handed down from teacher to student over thousands of years. The teacher you listen to inside your heart. Investigate the meaning of life. Investigate your spirituality. Let it unfold inside your life, like the blue sky or the sun, moon, and stars. This is a teacher too. Ultimately, the death of the body. This also is a teacher for us. Tash Mai means my offering. I give all my selfish needs and desires. I give it up at the feet of the Guru as an offering, completely. What asana practice is based on is the controlled introduction of stress into your life so that you could experiment with keeping a calm, stable mind under a stressful situation. We introduce stress in these ways by bending forward.
When you're in a forward bend, where do you stop pushing? Where do you stay with it? Where do you back off? Where do you just not try to do it, but be it? Where do you say, I want to go further, I want to go further because in going further, I'm reaching, and in that reaching, there's no grace without effort. You can feel your ego at work there. It's a question of effort and surrender.
We don't identify with the limitation, our inability to get our foot behind our head. If you come from a place that says, I can't do that, it affects what you're able to do. But if instead you come from a place that says, the breath moves in and the breath moves out, then you become more unlimited in what you can do in your body.
This is a very concrete dialogue. It's a very good active meditation on these very important questions. And I think everything in life has to do with how much effort and how much grace. I mean, that's why I respond so much to the asana practice, is it's so experiential.
In order to experience a breakthrough, we have to go to the end of an experience, meaning we have to really do it with all of our hearts. You must die in that asana class. Die to the past, die to the present, and just make the moment everything.
Yogaschitta Vritti Nirodha. Yoga is the cessation of the fluctuations of the mind. But it also could be translated as, yoga is when you can watch your mind think. This thing called the mind, which its business is to make vrittis, make fluctuations. This is good, this is bad, I like this, I don't like that. I'm happy, I could be happier, I'm sad, blah, 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 goes on and on and on and on and on.
Oh, look at the flowers. Purple flowers.
Now, when you can watch your mind think, when that is actually happening, then there is yoga.
We're trying to have an experience of the need to know, no need to know. It's not the getting there that's important or where we are going that's important.
We're going to now. Going to now.
Where are we?
Eternity,
we're right here.
Eternity is already happening.
It's here now, are you?
It's here now, are you?
Asana means seat. Seat means connection to the earth. So the practice of asana means really the practice of connecting to the earth, not only the ground that we walk upon, but the other beings that we come in contact with daily in our life. What we're actually doing is we're trying to relate our breath with our body in asana practice.
In yoga practice, it is taught that a smooth breath will create an evenness of the mind. In order to create a smooth breath, you must concentrate on the breath. If the breath becomes unconscious, it will become erratic or unregulated. After all, the goal is super consciousness, conscious of everything, conscious of the bottom of my big toe and every hair on my head and the movement of digestion inside and the breath as it comes in and it goes out. Learn how to concentrate on not your difficulty, but your freedom. The breath is a bridge to take us from here to there.
And if we can practice getting the breath and the body together, relating that, perfecting that relationship, start with that, then the other relationships in our life, like our relationship to the earth, to our parents, to the person we work for, to our husband, those relationships can become more related. It the yoga can happen.
It creates an ease and a centeredness that allows you to look at these things.
To actually be with these other things. And when we can really be with these other things and other people, we don't seem so alone. We start to see the interconnectedness. Bliss, ecstasy. That's what yoga is, ecstasy. To join together with the source. When you are joined together with the source, automatic samadhi, ecstasy, happiness. Forming your body in these various asanas, in these various positions, can help you to realize the natural state by showing you where you are resisting complete happiness.
Things were always painful when I was trying to get away from the pain. But if I went towards to investigate what actually was going on in my body and tried to actually sit with the sensation, it mysteriously disappeared as something that I saw as a negative thing.
Because you yoked with it. You created a relationship.
That's what was going on, and I was with it. I wasn't trying to be somewhere else.
Most of us identify with our bodies, but we don't really know our bodies. And through the yoga practice of asanas, you get to really know your body, inside and out. When you get to know your body on that level, you know you're not the body. You know that you're something else who's able to go in there and investigate.
Asana practice is, it's a concrete way to exercise equanimity of the mind and a certain kind of evenness.
You see how the mind and the body work, and that you can somehow detach from the body and the mind and play with the workings of the body and the mind. So you have the actual experience of doing something physical and how that affects you emotionally, psychologically.
You concentrate yourself. In other words, you don't think about a lot of thoughts. You think about just one little project, a task.
Like straightening your leg.
Or breathing evenly. Then, as a result of that, you become high. You become light.
It's a sense of feeling your place. I can only call it centeredness or equanimity or grace, gracefulness. And once you know that, just like once you know a certain kind of power, a certain kind of high in a performance, you want to extend that. That feels like that's the state that you should aspire to. Initially, I came to a yoga practice because I was looking for some sort of physical discipline. Sort of a very superficial narcissistic desire to keep your body fit and keep flexible and sort of keep your instrument tuned as a performer. But then in the asana practice, you start noticing certain patterns in the functions of the mind. And then once you start to know your mind and once you start to practice meditation and contemplation, I think that leads you to look inward, know yourself, and find how you are divine.
You start to become aware that there could be something else.
In the yoga practice, we teach you to stop identifying with the pain and suffering. You no longer can say, "I am sad," because you know that truly, I am. I am the primordial self. I am the divine manifesting. And I am experiencing incredibly strong sadness. I am experiencing wondrous happiness. but I am. And I am free of that sadness and that happiness. In fact, I am free to experience it to such a degree that I've never experienced it before, because I always resented the sadness. I always grabbed at the happiness, and now I am free and I am able to embrace the sadness. I am able to be drowned in the happiness most completely. The thoughts don't end when one is free from thought. It's the function of the mind to think. It stops thinking when it stops existing, this mind. This body stops feeling pain when it's in the ground. But I continue to exist. And I exist right now, free from pain and suffering, free from thought, if I know my true nature, which is I am. Not I am thinking, not I am David, not I am pained, but I am.
Our deepest fear is not that we are inadequate. Our deepest fear is that we are powerful beyond measure. It is our light, not our darkness, that most frightens us. There is nothing enlightened about shrinking so that other people will not feel insecure around you. And as we let our own light shine, we unconditionally give other people permission to do the same. As we are liberated from our own fears, our presence automatically liberates others. Nelson Mandela, 1994, inaugural speech.
One teacher told me, he said, "What is the hardest thing that you do every day?" He said, "Getting up. Getting out of bed is the hardest thing that you do every day." That's the start of your practice. Get up. Get up new every day. Get up fresh. From that point onward, what you have to do is be regular with a practice. It might mean that you just sit up in bed and every day you say, "I'm going to not just right away rush for that coffee, rush for that newspaper, or turn on the TV. I'm going to sit in silence for 2 minutes, and that's going to be how I'll start my day. And I'm going to do that every day." That would be the start of a practice. You do something that is within your capacity to do. And that will enlarge this practice in the way that it should. I know I started once a week. Gradually, twice a week, gradually, more and more. Ultimately, you do it every day. That's the important thing. The asana practice itself is not the difficulty. The difficulty is doing it with regularity and not giving in to the fluctuations of the mind. If I'm concentrating on the fact that I'm breathing in now and then breathing out now, I'm not worried about my problems. I'm concentrating on my breath. The commitment is important, and knowing the goal, having the goal in sight, that's important.
I guess I want to go back a little bit, and just so I understand the origin of the asanas, how they were developed.
Most of the yoga practices come from some experiment someone did at some point in time about how could I make myself happier? Mm-hmm. Let me just try here. Not going to a movie, not looking for another new novel. Just with this equipment, what could I do to make myself happy? So they tried rolling around on the ground, tried going upside down, and then they became a little happier and they said, oh, we'll call this asana practice. And it became formalized. But initially it was just, let me experiment in making myself happier. That simple, I think.
I always think back on the story of King Arthur in the Celtic legend and his guru, Merlin. And when Merlin was teaching the young king how to be the king of his kingdom, how he taught him was he transformed him into all of the different animals and plants, spirits, elemental forms, rocks and trees and mountains of his kingdom. So the young king had the direct experience of the form, of all the forms of his kingdom. What he was teaching him is yoga asanas. All the different forms, every form and shape that a human body could possibly take. You take that form and you have the experience. And then you have the knowledge of form. And then you know your kingdom.
It's said that the first teacher looked up in the sky and learned from birds. That the first teacher looked at the trees and learned from the trees. That the first teacher experienced the wind and learned from the wind. Each of us can do this. Ultimately, the teacher is consciousness itself.
Practices of yoga are practices to refine the mind, refine action, refine how you relate to the world and to the others in the world. Yoga is an experiential technique. Yoga is about what do you do and how do you do it. It starts in the everyday things we do. It's a level of consciousness. You know, the yogi becomes more conscious. The yogi begins to wake up to this truth that what you do matters a great deal. You begin then to be more conscious of your choices. What you choose to eat, what you choose to read, what you choose to talk about, what you choose to do. It's one of the reasons why yogis practice vegetarianism. We all know that a vegetarian diet causes the least harm to the planet and to all involved.
You said that the practice will go better if you have a vegetarian diet. And I initially followed that to some degree, and I'm moving towards that all the time. And the truth is, it just makes me feel better. And I also have lots of political concerns and health concerns about things like eating meat and eating dairy. All my instincts and what my body says about what I'm putting in it now as to what I would put in it before does make me think that this is a wise choice. Through experience, you make a choice and something becomes a part of your life.
We want to project ourselves into the world, maximum potential. Maximum potential, maximum efficiency, maximum result. How to do that? In everything, in personal life, in business, in the whole thing. We aren't excluding anything. But how to do that? One of our wonderful teachers, Brahmananda Saraswati, he would always say, if you're going to throw a ball, you can't just throw it from here. You have to draw back in to get the impetus to project it out. We have to draw back first and find, where am I? Where am I? Then you have the strength to go back into the world and operate on a level that you've never been aware of before.
This time in which we're living, the single most powerful spiritual practice is satsang.
Satsang is association with the enlightened mind of the masters. Satsang is being in the presence of pure love and devotion. My whole journey in India was satsang. All that I did was to put myself in the company of the great ones, the beggar on the street, the crippled boy who followed me out into the countryside. Because it's love. And when we're with people who are in love with God and not thinking of me, 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 but praising God and lifting our minds up, then this lifts us up. So you are who you hang out with, and it colors you.
The teaching is choose your company wisely. Choose what you surround yourself with, your participation in activities. You need to develop satsang. You need to attach yourself to the point of addiction to the truth. This is satsang. We're having satsang. We come together for the single purpose of realizing the truth. If we can't realize it, well, we can talk about it, maybe.
People that don't know yoga practices firsthand almost assume that yoga is a religion.
There are so many religions, and so many wars have been started over religion. A big part of religion, organized religion, is separation. It's saying, I'm a Jew, you're a Christian, you're a Buddhist, we are different. And we're going to do everything we can to establish our differences. Yoga says, we're all in this together. Let's know that. That's a real basic, important difference between yoga practice and religion.
Not even that we're all in this together, we are all this. Together, we are all this.
You're a special snowflake. So it's like finding your way. Find the way for you. And it's your own religion. So it might mean chanting and asana practice and walking in the woods and sitting on a certain space or worshiping your cat or eating your food very slowly with mindfulness. It could be engaging in a very intense business practice and flying all over the world and creating something else as your religion and your gift. So it's finding your own art in life and seeing that life is that art and that is your religion.
I think you do have an obligation in this life to make something or to do something. And some people put forward that your job in this life is to realize God. And I'm very interested in that.
God is another name for yourself, your divine self, your true self.
There's no difference between you and God.
The practices of yoga are simply practices to make yourself ready to receive. You're creating an abode for grace to be attracted to.
At one point, Patanjali says only three steps are necessary to set yourself free. Tapas, turning up the heat, keeping things intense for yourself. Swadhyaya, study of the self. Adhyaya means study. Swa means the self, the true self. Ishvara pranidhan. Isha means God. Prana is your life force, and dan means to give. You could say that this means giving your energy to knowing God. Asana practice is an example of tapas, keeping the fire, literally, underneath your investigation. We know when we're being lazy. So you apply some tapas, some heat to things, and you bring up the boil again. All you really need to do is be devoted. And this is difficult for people to find inside of an asana practice. In a practice that is so based on my physical body, how do I get devotion? It's the responsibility of the teacher to tell you, to give the clues from the scriptures. That cannot be neglected. And if it's neglected, that's when the difficulty arises, that the teachings become shallow.
You can direct the mind towards God, the divine, towards samadhi. Or you can direct the mind towards slimming down the body or becoming stronger or building up the biceps or whatever. And you will get that. But that is limiting compared to you could become same as the highest. You could become your divine self.
You've got to have the passion, the desire, the energy in the moment to bring you into the practice. Otherwise, there's no stoke in your practice. There's no juice in your practice. Otherwise, you're a dilettante. Spirituality is not a hobby. Every moment is fleeting. There's a myth that people believe in, which is, I will grow old and die. It may not be so. There's death every moment. You must confront death and find the other side of it. This is going to create a depth in your practice, because when you embrace the darkness, in the darkness is the light.
The breath comes and goes. It's just like life itself. It comes and it goes.
So many of our actions in this world seem to be driven by a sense of where we're going, and that all leads us to the difficulty of impermanence and also the fact that we're all going to die, we're going to leave this body. And I think people deal with that in different ways, but I think there's very few people that are at peace with that without some sort of practice or refinement or training.
Relax your body and let us in tune our mind with this light. Thank you.
you could take a certain amount of time every day and breathe in and breathe out and focus on that, then you would derive tremendous inner strength that will allow you to go closer to the source of your being, which is lasting happiness, which is beyond thought, beyond any level of definition. The whole purpose is to refine your perception in order to see the oneness in all things. You have to, first of all, see one thing. When you can truly see one thing and hold that object for some duration, then what occurs is you burst through the illusion of separateness, and you know that one thing as everything.
I feel one with all that exists. I consider universe as my homeland.
You are a blessed soul. Your main duty should be to go beyond thoughts, which create all sorts of fluctuations in life. And then the mind and the heart will be united as one. The ending of knowledge is the beginning of wisdom.
Suddenly you know there's not one that is concentrating and something that is being concentrated on and an act of concentrating, but it all merges together and it's the same. There's no object of meditation in you. There it just is. There's isness. Yoga is like becoming a baby again, becoming reunited with the source, remembering who we are and where we came from, so that we don't feel alone and separate. Sometimes it's called that voice inside that stays the same. With what's referred to as the third eye, we look inside. And with that look, we come to know the source of being.
It's all vibration.
Right. And it's the same as that inner essence. Yeah. So rock and us share a similarity, but different rates of vibration.
Matter is sound, slowed down so that the eyes can see it, so that the ears can hear it, the nose can smell it. But it's all sound. Everything is vibration.
In other words, there's nothing in the house but God. God is in the rock, in the sidewalk, in the eyes of the children, in the eyes of the old woman who passes you by. See God in the world. Be here, now, in this world. This is it. Don't try to get out of it. Get into it. tuning in like a radio. You're finding where you can hear the nod. You can hear the sound. That sound is always in everyone. It's ringing into everyone's skulls. It's the pulse of life. The life force is gone. Everyone is alive.
Anyone could have yoga or samadhi if they want to simply look more deeply into things. The development of perception is really what the yoga practices are about. To look deeper into things, to see ourselves in others. And then to go beyond seeing, samadhi, to go beyond seeing and to actually be yourself in that other, until otherness disappears.
In samadhi, there's no differences. All of a sudden, everything is, the sama is the same.
There is only pure being, and there's a word for that pure being, yoga.
You're engaged, your hands are full. Your body's full. You are it. That's where I want to be. That's where I want to live.
For me, the vehicle to search what is truth.
There's so much faith involved in yoga and in being in the present and not being afraid of what's going to come next.
Water's rising to my bed. My quilt is floating on the rolling flood, leaving my shelter down, down. Oh, bow of the road, oh, bow my heart. What keeps me tied to the corner of the room? What keeps me tied?
Everyone is on this incredible adventure. Everyone who's born is a hero. Every soul that comes through the doorway of life, every soul is it.
Slowly, slowly, by doing the asanas on a day-to-day basis, you're opening yourself up to realizing that which is inside of you, the divine inside.
Yoga is a question that leads to a question that leads to a question. When that question moves beyond the body, when the answer begins to come from the heart, then I think you've got the start of a yoga practice.
Our home is here in this temple. We're here to come back again, to go home.
Bow all of the road. Oh, bow my heart. What keeps me tied to the corner of the room? What keeps me tied? What keeps me tied to the corner of the room? What keeps me tied?
The first thing that we do when we come into this life is to inhale. And the last thing that we will do before leaving this life